I'm Dr. Tony DeFrance, and I'm an interventional cardiologist. I'm based out in the West Coast. I'm on faculty at Stanford, and I've been doing cardiac CT. I'm an interventional guy, and I did interventions for 10 years and have been focused more on imaging, namely cardiac CT angiography, for the last 10 years. And I teach that a bunch and travel, and I've also been getting more involved in making some of the rule sets for cardiovascular imaging. And so the talk title today is Best Practices in Cardiovascular Imaging. So I'm going to take you through that now. So what I'd like to cover while you're enjoying your lunches here is how, you know, the title is Best Practices in Cardiovascular Imaging, but I think that's really a moving target, and I probably would have given a different talk 2 years, even a year ago, than now with all the changes going on. It's becoming more and more about efficiency and value in imaging, and I'm going to go through that. I'm going to give you some clinical case examples and hopefully use this. I have a workstation up here to show you a couple recent cases that we've done and highlight some of the advantages of wide area detectors, some of the cath lab advantages in the case I'll show you, and some near future technology with mainly with cardiac CT. So why is best practices a moving target? Well, one of the big things, as most of you in the room obviously know, is there's a lot of changes going on in healthcare right now. There's a big drive towards value and efficiency. Also, we see it's a moving target because as the technology advances, clinical pathways can change. New clinical pathways are developing with these advances in technology, especially cardiac CT. I think that's one that's come in and is kind of a game changer in some ways. So what's driving this change, this move towards more efficiency, value, and the healthcare change? Well, as you know, healthcare costs are now at about just almost 17% of our gross domestic product, and the costs of care are rising. They've leveled off a little bit, but they're still going up year over year. There's all kinds of predictions of doomsday, but in its current form, Medicare is non-sustainable probably in 6 or 8 years. It will not have the money to go on, and part of that is because of the baby boomers flooding into the the healthcare system and turning 65 at a very rapid rate. What's also driving the change is our fragmented, complex system, and I'll show you some slides on that, both in terms of reimbursement and in patient care. And we have a system based on volume. Physicians or others can be incentivized by doing more procedures, and so they're trying to change that from a volume incentive to a value or quality metric incentive. This is one of these lovely graphs that we show that illustrates the baby boomers right here, and this is over the next 18 years as baby boomer generation. We got about over 3 million a year turning 65. There's one statistic. There's a baby boomer turning 65 every 8 seconds for the next 18 years. That's pretty amazing. And so they, you know, there's a lot of fear that's going to overwhelm the system that's in place, the Medicare system. So we, it's predicted we'll have just about 80 million Medicare beneficiaries by 2030. It's a big number and a lot of money to take care of it. So this statement here, we'd like to migrate from a fragmented volume-based system to one that is driven by value, accountability, quality, and outcomes. This comes directly, I lifted this directly from CMS, from Medicare and some of their documents. So this is the direction that they want to move, and it's not that new. Some people think it's Obamacare, the new changes. This has been going on for more than a decade, their move towards, away from the fragmented volume-based system to a more quality metric system. You know, and this is what our system looks like. It's a great one, but, you know, we have imaging centers, outpatient hospitals, et cetera, long-term care facilities, ambulatory care centers, and there's all these different payment entities that happen and different rules and regulations around them. So what the government is looking to do is kind of create more of a single payment system, a hospital episode-based payment. For acute episodes, they're going to in the very near future give one payment to the hospital, and everyone's got to go to the hospital to get paid for what they're doing. So that's for an acute episode of care. It'll include the 3 days before the hospitalization, and 30 days after. So that's a big change in the way things are done now. So really, a lot of what's going on is the power structure is changing. Hospitals are gaining more power in this new environment. They're acquiring a number of cardiology practices, as many of you probably know. There's some estimates 30 to 40% of cardiology practices in the U.S. have already been purchased by hospitals, and that trend is expected to continue over the next couple of years. And one of the, you know, there's many reasons why they're doing it, but one of the big ones that we've heard is that we're going to ensure clinical, operational, and cost efficiencies. Hospitals have to become more cost efficient in this new environment, and to do that, they need to be able to control the docs, their ordering patterns, how they use imaging equipment and clinical pathways. And they're preparing for these new reimbursement structures where you have a single payment to the hospital system. And as you guys all know as well, we have declining reimbursement for imaging going on, and that's really hitting the backbone of cardiology, making the hospitals in many cases able to acquire these practices all over. So we're really switching from a volume-based system to a value-based system. And it's really not all that new. Like I said, a lot of this stuff started back in 2000. There's a number of rules and regulations that Medicare has put in place. I'm not going to go into these in any detail. But this sweeping change from volume to value-based has been going on over a number of years. So it's becoming about clinical efficiency, operational efficiency, financial efficiency, and really value. When I say efficiency, it kind of has a bad connotation, but clinical value, improving the value of what we're doing. Medicare is going to become more of a healthcare purchaser than a passive entity. And there's going to be metrics put in place at several levels to measure these sorts of things. Okay, so you guys have heard of some of these, probably paid for performance, present on admission, changes to the DRGs that are occurring, accountable care organizations, episodes of care. All those things are in place. So the changes to the DRG, they're turning into cost-based, and there's going to be more and more bundling. There's going to be benchmarking for different clinical entities that's already in place with stiff penalties. If people don't meet them, Medicare is withholding 2% of whatever they paid the hospital last year until they meet certain benchmarks. Those things are all going into place. And also present on admission, you're going to get paid for the diagnosis made up front when the patients hit the door and not for things that develop after that. This whole episode of care concept is what I mentioned earlier, is basically once they, for the 3 days before they're acutely ill and admitted to the hospital, the hospitalization, and the 30 days after, there's going to be a single payment for that. And there's other models that are looking at these accountable care organizations run by primary care physicians where they get, it's kind of a medical savings program where the physicians will get a bucket of money and they need to optimally take care of the patients. So I think that's enough. I know this is a talk on imaging, but I'm kind of giving you a little backdrop on what's going to really drive imaging in this new way. These accountable care organizations, value-based purchasing by Medicare. They want to get rid of the preventable readmissions. They're going to do these episode-based payments and reduce iatrogenic illnesses. So they're moving towards quality and reducing costs. And around, you know, they feel that the electronic medical record is going to tie a lot of these things together. That's sort of the plan that you can see unfolding here. So I think the new paradigm, it's not about thinking how much are we going to get reimbursed for a test. It's really about efficiency and getting cost out of the system that we're going to be looking towards over the next couple of years. Performing to metrics with optimum use of imaging, like capturing all diagnoses up front, effective triage at the door, and admitting the high acuity patients and discharging home the lower acuity patients. So episodes of care and best patient care pathways are going to change, I think, and the hospitals are going to want cardiologists and other physicians to use these more efficient pathways. And for physicians, we're going to need to innovate to prosper in this new environment. It's going to not be about volume. So we're going to get incentivized and paid based on value-based metrics and efficiency, not volume. What the question is what are these metrics going to be? Hopefully they're not things like CHF out the door within 3.2 days, but they'll find good quality metrics that are really patient-centric. So that's the kind of backdrop. I know that was a few slides about healthcare economics. Let's go through some more clinical cases and things. And I'm going to use chest pain as the best practice in imaging kind of model here. And I'll illustrate some of the pathways, value and efficiency. I'm going to highlight wide volume CT, a couple of cath lab improvements, and discuss some near future applications of technology. And again, all of this relates to chest pain. I didn't do acute stroke. I'm a cardiologist, as I said, but I think in acute stroke, there's some really exciting things going on as well. So first of all, talking about chest pain in the emergency department. There's long triage times, emergency department congestion. We have increased hospital costs, unnecessary admissions. In the U.S., we have about 6 million visits a year for chest pain. And just figuring out what's wrong, the diagnostic costs are estimated to be around $14 to $16 billion a year. So that's not for the treatment, that's figuring out what's wrong with the patients. After all that, about somewhere between 75 and 85% of patients who show up with chest pain do not end up having an acute coronary syndrome or a coronary disease cause of their chest pain. So we're looking for that 15 to 20% and we're spending a lot of money to do it. And all of you, I'm sure many cardiologists in the room, probably a mixture, but chest pain, you know, the standard workup is the following. We do a history and physical, we get an EKG chest x-ray, troponins, we evaluate their clinical risk. So what I mean by that is, are they at high risk of death or are they at lower intermediate risk of death? And there's plenty of tables to show that. Do they have pulmonary edema, is it prolonged chest pain, ST depression, high troponin? So you can tell the ones that are at high risk of death and get them right to an invasive strategy. The ones that aren't at high risk of death, we figure out the pretest probability, and then we figure out what test to order. Okay, so again, getting the high risk of death patients out to an invasive strategy early is important, so that would be cath lab. And again, I didn't put that table in there, but there's plenty of those tables in the cardiology literature. So those patients that are not at high risk of death, the intermediate or low risk of death, many of you have seen this table. It's published over and over in almost every American College of Cardiology document, is this pretest probability table. We can look at the patient's age and gender and how typical their anginal symptoms are to tell what their pretest probability of disease is. So a 52-year-old man who has atypical angina has intermediate pretest probability, for example. Basic stuff, right? So we use that to figure out what tests we're going to use. So again, just to emphasize, in the emergency department chest pain patient, we have our high-risk individuals with positive troponins, hypotension, ischemic EKG changes. They just need to go to the lab. Then we have our lower intermediate risk, and we can break those into high pretest probability, those that have 90% or greater chance of having coronary disease. They go to the lab. We have our intermediate probability. Those go to the non-invasive evaluations and low probability as well. Then we have sometimes our very low probability, obviously not coronary disease. Hopefully they go home, but in this medical legal environment, they'll often leave with some sort of testing being done as well. The interesting thing is if you look at emergency departments, about 85% of people that show up fall into this category, okay, in multiple studies in emergency departments. So 75 to 80% of people, 85%, fall into this low-risk, intermediate, or low-probability chest pain category. And I'm going to, you know, the standard of care has been using either stress echo or stress nuclear to assess those intermediate probability and low pretest probability patients. What I'm going to talk about now is possibly using cardiac CT in those intermediate and low-probability patients. There's been about 25 studies on using cardiac CT in the emergency department arena. And those show that it's a faster modality, it gets it done faster than the others, it's less expensive than a standard of care like nuclear, it's highly accurate, it compares very well to catheterization. When I say it provides more information, when we're doing CT, we're seeing the lungs, the esophagus, we find other causes of chest pain that are not the heart, and we see the myocardium, pericardium valves, et cetera. We see all of the heart, not just the coronaries. And now, more and more with new technology, this can be done with very low radiation doses. So this is from, kind of compiled several studies. This is just sort of elevator speech. Cardiac CT is about a third less cost than a nuclear strategy in the ED, takes half the amount of time, has a lower radiation dose than the nuclear strategy, and several studies have shown that we can get about 75% of people right out of the emergency department no admit, no holding units with a cardiac CT strategy. That's a big deal. I'm going to show you that in a minute. And those 75% that are discharged, they followed them out now in some studies 2 and 3 years. There are no events. So when you send them out with a normal or near normal cardiac CT, they do not have clinical events, acute MIs, acute coronary syndromes. The CT stat trial is one of the bigger ones. It's just in its final publication phases, 16 hospitals. They compared CT to nuclear, 750 patients. Bottom line, they discharge, this number about 80% keeps coming up, 82%, no significant stenosis, 9% moderate, 8% had severe, and there was no difference in invasive strategy. Some people have worried if we do CT, it's an anatomic modality, we're going to do more angioplasty and interventions, but that was not really true in this study. So a very effective way to get about 80% of the people out of the ED quickly with no events. Here's the decrease in cost with a CT strategy versus a nuclear, and they were very conservative, so they did quite a bit of secondary testing. I think it would be even less expensive in a non-trial environment. Half the time, here's the hours in the emergency department. The first run of this trial, their ED chest pain workup times were about 13 hours. That's pretty standard in the U.S., 10 to 13 hours to get someone in and out with chest pain. And now with a CT strategy in this trial, they get down to under 3. So less time to diagnosis, less cost, and a third less radiation. Again, they use a conservative strategy, but the CT arm was about 10 millisieverts using more. They did a lot of retrospective CT, so now we're using more prospective, and that's compared to nuclear. So here's some stuff off the 320. I think I told you at the beginning, I work on a 64 Toshiba and a 320. Here's some data off the 320, and that's some of the images I'm going to show you in a few minutes. Michael Poon at Stony Brook just did this, 1,000 or 1,100 patients with chest pain. They got 85% of them out of the ED with CT. With their non-CT strategy, which they compared it to, which was mainly nuclear, 50% of the people would get admitted. So this is a marked decrease in the amount of people they're admitting. And with a CT strategy, they only ended up having to admit 15% versus 50% with a non-CT strategy in the emergency room. Each unnecessary admission, they figured out the hospital cost was $5,000. So when he kind of totaled it up, for every 250 admissions saved, they saved about $1.3 million. So that's been a big... This study, again, has been published in its initial form. That's a big savings to the hospital. And this is exactly the kind of cost efficiency, clinical efficiency. You know, these people don't come back with events. They don't get readmitted with a CT strategy, and they're saving money. So that's exactly the kind of efficiency they're looking at. I work very closely with a 320 program in Australia. I have the privilege of going over there several times a year in Melbourne. And they have a 320 and a very nice ED program. They use CT to triage all their emergency department patients. So of the, they have to be low and intermediate pretest probability, not the sick ones. They go to the cath lab. So when they took a large group of consecutive chest pain patients, again, 85% seems too good to be true, but that number keeps coming up. Had normal or mild disease by cardiac CT. No events when the CT strategy was used for discharge. Lower admission rates, about 1% admission rate versus 9% for their standard of care. They use more stress echo over there than nuclear, but that was the difference. So, you know, it looks, and there's about 20 more studies. If you like, I'll put my email address up at the end. I can send you a reference list by email. Of all the emergency department studies, there's a number of good ones which I can't cover here. So what I'm going to cover now is basically some clinical advantages of 320 detector CT. So helical cardiac scanning with a 64, for example, takes 6 or 8 seconds, and we kind of compile the data sets from 4, 5, 6 heartbeats, depending on the machine. And most 64s do a very nice job. I have a 64 at one of our centers, and it does quite well. But with 64, you're scanning again over the 6 beats, and what you're counting on is the heart to swing back to the same spot with each subsequent heartbeat, and the heart rate has to be very well controlled. So from the first slab from the first heartbeat, I get this slab of data from the second, that, third, fourth, fifth heartbeat, etc. And those, the computers obviously splice them together almost like one of those panoramic photos. Now, if the heart doesn't move back to the exact same spot, you get this. Now, I did this artificially, but this is misregistration or step artifact. And this is one of the things that kills us in multi-slice cardiac CT. Then your coronaries are shifted all over. So that's one of the potential downsides. And that's why you really need excellent heart rate control and very, very little heart rate variability in general. With a 320 detector CT, the entire data set is taken in one snapshot, because we can do up to 16 centimeters of volume in a single snapshot, so there's we don't stitch together slabs of data. It's all taken simultaneously, and it can be done in about a third of a second. And this is what it looks like once the gantry gets rotating. Basically, you know, takes just a piece, that would be a prospective. We just took a little part of the cardiac cycle, snapped the shot. We can get the whole 16-centimeter volume, and that's a big advantage for several things. And we call that temporal uniformity. It's like it's taken all at the same point in time with a 320. So no misregistration or step artifact. The contrast is the same everywhere, and that becomes very important for a new application I'm going to show you, which is using CT to do perfusion studies. So CT myocardial perfusion, having homogeneous contrast, same contrast everywhere, is quite important. We've noted less artifacts with calcium and stents because of this, you know, partly because we don't have step artifacts and we don't have any cardiac vein interference. We've also noted that we're using less contrast with the 320 since the image is so quick. We can give smaller boluses of contrast and snap the shot. So our average contrast, we've actually even gotten lower, 40 to 50 now, but right around 50 cc's is probably a pretty standard contrast bolus for us. And this is why with a 64, you have to keep, it takes several seconds to do the study. You have to keep the heart well contrasted. With a 320, it's almost instantaneous, so you can use less contrast. Now, here are some of the acquisition modes. We do a full beat in some cases. This would be a full beat study. This would be retrospective imaging, right? You can see these because we can slice that up and look at 10% of the cardiac cycle, 20, 30, 40, and make nice motion image. That's retrospective CT with a 320, one heartbeat. And these, they've already played through, but these make really nice functional images. We can do one beat with dose modulation. So if we want to save radiation dose, we can turn the MA down during systole and up during diastole. That'll save about 25-30% of the dose. Most of what we do, though, about 85% of what I do is this, which is prospective imaging. If I have a nice controlled heart rate, I just turn the beam on for 70-80% of one cardiac cycle, and we can still do multiple reconstructions within there. So we can go 70, 72, 74, 70. So we can still get multiple reconstructions in case there's any blurriness or motion in the coronaries. And that works very well for us. And then we're getting radiation doses, as I'll show you, down around 2 millisieverts. The other cool thing about this technology is if there's an arrhythmia, it's very smart. It watches the heartbeat before you start. It knows what the normal RR interval should be. And if it starts imaging and an R wave comes in early, it'll stop. And it'll skip to the next beat and start. So just imagine, you can do atrial fibrillation, and there have been several trials looking at doing AFib, because you just need the info from one cardiac cycle. So if there's a real short R-wave cycle, it will stop there and go to the next one. We've done a large number of AFib studies that usually work out quite well, as long as the heart rate's not like 110 or something. So it's been flexible. We have these different protocols, single beat, dose modulation, prospective. And we found it's very adaptable with this arrhythmia rejection and some heart rate protocols. So we're able to kind of expand the group of patients that are candidates. And we've been finding better image quality, very high quality images off the 320. And I'll show you some of these. And a lot of it's because most of the artifacts are basically gone. And speaking of radiation dose, you know, here's the typical with the nuclear med, typical stress system maybe or something here. Typically quoted 14 millisieverts or so. Retrospective 64, that was about 14, 12 to 14, maybe even up to 16 depending. But with prospective now, even on a 64, we can get it down in a lower range. Diagnostic cath, somewhere usually quoted in the literature, hard to find exactly, somewhere around 6 millisieverts for a non-complicated cath. And then with prospective 64, you can get it down around 5 or 6 millisieverts. With the 320, we're getting studies down around 2 millisieverts. Okay, so we've seen a dramatic reduction in dose and contrast. We've seen improved image quality. And these are, again, my experiences. We've had our 320. We got one of the first ones in the U.S., so we've had it since 2007. So I guess that's going on 4 years. We have more rapid patient turnovers. We can do 5, 6 an hour pretty easily, and we can do it on a wider range of patients. So now we're going to switch to hopefully some interesting stuff, a little clinical data. I'm going to show you a couple cases. This is the first case done, a chest pain in the emergency department, 52-year-old male. He's got some shoulder pain with exertion, so that would be atypical symptoms. Primary care actually thought it was a rotator cuff injury, so we gave him some Motrin for a couple weeks, and the guy came back and said, no, it's not better. So then he sent the primary care sent it to a cardiologist, sent the patient to a cardiologist. And in this particular case, I said he's 52, he's a male, and he's got atypical symptoms, right? So he's one of these intermediate pretest probability patients. This is a perfect candidate for either stress nuclear stress echo, or in this case, we use cardiac CT. Obviously, first step, normal 12-lead EKG, normal enzymes. So this is, I'm just loading the raw DICOM data that comes off the CT. It hasn't been processed. This is all being done in the background by the workstation. This is a vitreo workstation. And so, you guys have seen these, I'm sure, but you can see some of these nice 3D images. Here's the left anterior descending. Here's the circumflex. Here's the right coronary artery. And there's the distal right. Looks nice. You can come in here and look at origins of the coronary arteries from above here. This is the origin of the right coronary, origin of the left main over here. So you can see nice normal origins. You can see the quality of this case. I'll show you the data with which we acquired this in just a minute. But let's go in and look at his coronary arteries. I'm going to skip. Normally what I do is I'd walk through and look at the myocardium, the pericardium, the valves, the chambers. And it puts it automatically into echocardiographic type views. Here's a four chamber. You can see compare chambers. Here is a short axis of the heart, and here would be a two chamber. And we can see myocardial infarctions nicely if there are any, and there's obviously not in this case. So I'm what you call a vessel walker. I like to kind of come up here. Let me zoom up a little bit and kind of walk my way down these vessels. Here's the left main. Here's the LAD. I'm walking down that, and I rotate them so I make sure there's nothing hiding. Here is a little, you see this right here? Let me see if I can zoom that up. So totally normal lumen, but he's got a little fleck of calcium in the wall of his coronary artery. Maybe a little bit of non-calcified plaque there as well, but totally non-obstructive disease. This would be put into the mild to normal category. So this gentleman, unless I find something here as we move through, I'm moving into the circumflex territory. The rest of his coronaries are stone cold normal. That's the only thing he has is a tiny fleck of calcium. So he's going to be discharged from the emergency department. Let me just look at his right here. Quickly and efficiently without, sitting in there for 13 hours or whatever it takes. Here's the right coronary artery. And again, you can see really minimal atherosclerosis. And you see there's no such thing as step artifacts. So some of you guys do cardiac CT, and you may have some step artifacts, et cetera. You don't see that on these wide volume detector images. Now, how did we do that? We gave him oral beta blockers. Our protocol is when we know they're going to go to the CT or when we suspect, we'll give them 100 of oral beta blockers in the emergency department. By the time the wheels get in motion, the CT clears the head trauma and all the stuff that's going on, usually an hour has passed. So that's what we like to see, 60 minutes or so. And he was in the scanner 1.2 hours after he hit the door. He was on the scanner, he was only in the CT suite 16 minutes. Here's his, we did him from 70 to 85%. We turned the beam on of his cardiac cycle. We used 40 cc's of contrast, KVP 120, MA 400. His total dose, 2.8 millisieverts. So nice low dose CT in the ED study. When we narrow the window even more, turn it on from 70 to 80, we probably would have had that down around 2 millisieverts. So, but very acceptable radiation doses. So in this case, value and efficiency, you know, it was efficient. We got him in and out of the ED in a couple of hours, low-dose contrast, low-dose radiation, non-invasive, and there's been several studies saying very low chance this guy's going to come back or get retested. People feel very confident when they have this kind of anatomy. It's operationally efficient. He got in and out of the ED in 2 hours, minimal ED bed use, and it's more cost-efficient for the hospital. So here's a second patient. This one, actually, I just got this morning from Australia. And this one, I read someone from over there, 56-year-old male, presented with atypical chest pain, no known medical problems, family history. And they decided, again, he was sort of one of these low to intermediate pretest probability patients, good candidate. So he's going to have a cardiac CT. All right, so this is going to load up. Again, this is a 320. The workstation processes it, takes off the ribs, chest wall, and gets it all set up for you. If I wanted, I could let it probe the vessels for me where it straightens the vessels out. But I'm kind of a, I just like to do it manually and walk the vessels. So I'm going to sort of hop. So right at, this is the left main. Let me switch that over and switch this. Okay, so here's the left main coronary artery. You can see here there's sort of a trifurcation there. It looks like there's a ramus intermedius, okay, a vessel that splits the LAD and the circ. And the origin of the circumflex has, the origin of the left anterior descending circumflex is coming down this way. The origin of the LAD obviously has very severe stenosis in it. I think this is a big septal perforator there. The LAD is actually over here, so I'm following it down. Looks like there's another area right in. See, this is why it's so important to vessel walk and twist and turn these things. You kind of look in and go, oh, it's okay. But then I turn this thing on its side, not so okay, right? Now you're seeing this. That's the beauty of cardiac CT. You have thousands of angles from which you can look at any one point in the coronary arteries versus in the cath lab, you get 4 or 5 angles on your LAD. So that's at least moderate stenosis. I would think that's getting up towards severe. And what we can do here, we can vessel probe these things too. Use this little finger here, click, and it should create a nice kind of images for us here that we can see the whole artery stretched out, and we can kind of click in there and look at cross-sectional areas. We can do some more fancy things where we, you know, have it help us measure the area. And what I did, I told you I'm an interventional guy, not doing interventions anymore, but I used to take, when I'd have the CT data, I'd know the size of the reference lumen, you can see it here, the area, diameter, I'd know the length of the lesion, I can kind of carefully pull this in and say, all right, I'm going to stent from, for example, here to here, you can see these numbers in the very bottom, I'd need a 20 millimeter stent. I'd know what my reference is, about 4.2 centimeters, millimeters, so I could choose the stent appropriately, walking into the lab feeling pretty confident. I know where the side branches are. So there's a lot of pre-procedure planning you can do with cardiac CT in the coronaries and very much so in the peripheral, in the periphery as well. I know a lot of you guys are peripheral vascular people. So pretty interesting stuff we can do here. And going to go ahead. Let's see, is there any other disease here? I think that's the major disease. Let me turn that off and turn this off. Take a quick look around. It looks like there's a little bit of disease and kind of lumps and bumps in the LAD, but I think there's two severe lesions. Obviously very severe at the origin, and I would grade that second one as severe. Some mild disease in the circumflex, OM, obtuse marginal, and it's a big, it looks like a dominant circumflex. I'm following it all the way down underneath the heart. It's going to give off the posterolateral and the posterior descending coronary arteries way out here. So this is a big, this is a left dominant system, and I would expect the right to be quite small. Let's take a quick look at that. And in fact, it's just a tiny right that gives off an RV marginal branch and a conus. Okay, so same thing on him. We gave him oral beta blocker before. It took about an hour and a half to get him on the CT. CT was done. He was back 14 minutes. We used similar parameters on him, a little higher MA, so his dose was around 3 millisieverts, 50 cc's of contrast. So again, very reasonable to get him in and out of the emergency department. So here's the images. Now this is also done on a Toshiba cath lab, and I love these Toshiba cath labs. The image quality, you can see here, we're over the spine, but and the patient's breathing, but you can see the whole vessel because of their advanced imaging processors. There's a high-grade stenosis there and the proximal LAD. Here's our second stenosis, and not a great shot for the circumflex.
Okay.
So there it is. That's a good shot. There's that severe subtotal LAD hanging by a thread, circumflex. Again, high-quality images. They came up through the groin here, but more and more, probably, I think there's a talk going on in the other room right now, we would have done this radially. And I'll show you some advantages of this particular cath lab for doing it radially. But really high-quality images that are very reproducible. So I'll just show you a couple really quick slides, some advantages of these particular cath labs that I have experienced. You know, there's different systems that you can use, biplane, ceiling-mounted. Dual plane's a nice solution. Many of you do peripheral and coronary work. This is really nice because you can have the best of both worlds, have small flat panel displays for steep angles for your coronaries, but have the dual plane, it brings it in separately, and you can have the larger panels for your peripheral work. This is how this thing works. It can be parked out of the way. So this would be the big panel for peripheral work, and then you can bring in the smaller C-arm, or the C-arm with the smaller flat panel, to get into these really steep coronary angles, and that parks out of the way. So you can do it in a regular size cath lab room, and I've worked on one of these. These are really nice to be able to do both peripheral and coronary work. And again, these different flat panel detectors for coronaries, 8x8 is great, brain 12x12, and if you want the wide area for peripheral, they have the 12x16s. And this is we have one of these five-axis positioner. You can get the C-arm completely out of the way, really axis. You can get the entire head is clear, so we can get anesthesia in there. We do some of these are in a lot of pediatric hospitals as well, with all the equipment they bring in, ECMO machines, cardiopulmonary bypass, and you have complete access to the patient. This moves completely out of the way. You can see there, this is completely out of the way, so anesthesia could be in there working on that patient. Also, for radial axis, it's really nice. It's one of the only the C-arms that actually it'll move 4 feet laterally in either direction, so you can get right over there and work on the radials, and here it shows that kind of transit. Since radial is becoming more and more important in the cath lab. Also, the monitors will move anywhere. When I used to do radials on my old system, I'd be like over here looking backwards. Now they can... monitors will position 360 degrees around the room so you can keep looking. All right, so I want to show you, just kind of summing up that case again, we took him first to the CT, then to the cath lab. We did rapid evaluation, low radiation contrast dose. We got him triaged and moved out of the ED into the cath lab where they had a plan for intervention. They knew what size stent, what length stent they were going to use. That thing's right at the origin of the LAD, so that looked like, I don't have the intervention film. I don't know exactly what they did. Like I said, I just got that case this morning, but that's a nasty, nasty looking LAD. And the CT allows you to really plan the PCI. No one's done a study showing if it improves restenosis rates or reduces complications, hopefully that will be done if you have a CT-guided study. So the patient was ambulated and discharged quickly. All right, I'm going to show you one last case, and we'll start winding it up here. This is kind of a near-future case, 66-year-old male with atypical chest pain seen in the outpatient setting. He's got a little elevated LDL, but not much in the way of risk factors. All right, so I'm going to load up. Again, this was done, we can do 70 to 80% of the cardiac cycle, but do multiple reconstructions within that 70 to 80%. So let me show you here this particular case. I'm going to just jump to the coronaries here. And this gentleman has the disease, right? So we see... quite a bit of calcification. Fix that and there. All right, so we see quite a bit of calcification in the proximal LAD. So we can kind of zoom in here. Now, a lot of times, as you know, calcium can look a lot worse than it is. So what we do is we go to thin slice. We thin the slices down, and we can use different window levels to help reduce the amount of blooming. Now, that's a non-obstructive stenosis. You can see, hopefully, yeah, the lumen nicely there. There's a little bit of non-calcified plaque. See the dark stuff before it? Right in there. But that's mild. That's less than 50% stenosis. As we move down the LAD, he has a little bit more here. And let me thicken up so I can move around. And this is the area, I think it was right in here, which I was concerned about. I'm going to thin down one more time. I'm using a kind of different slab thicknesses to navigate around. I was a bit worried about this LAD right here, you know. And when we looked at it in various recons, we thought it was close to 70. So that would make it a severe stenosis. Also, I was concerned about a stenosis in the diagonal branch here. Let me thicken up. I thought this stenosis in the diagonal was actually quite severe. I have it windowed funny to get the calcium out. That's a little better there. So I called, you know, possible severe stenosis here. It's right on the verge. And then I was pretty convinced that that in the diagonal branch was severe. He's got a huge... Again, another very big circumflex, but no stenosis in there. And let me look quickly at the right, and I'm going to show you some cool technology that we used in him that most people haven't seen yet. So this is, again, he's got kind of lumpy, bumpy coronaries, right? He's got disease, but not real severe obstructive in the right. Might have been a little something. I was a little concerned about this. We're way out here, but that's the bifurcation of the posterior descending and posterior lateral. So what did we do in him? Actually, we're using this new technology out of Stanford that I'll show you in a minute. You know, and one of the limitations of CT, though, first is it's an anatomic modality, right? So sometimes we have these, I don't know, is it 60%, is it 70%, what do I do? Do I go to the cath lab? Do I not? Do I do a nuclear? So that's one of our Achilles heels, so to speak. Obviously, heavy calcified vessels are a problem with cardiac CT. And precisely quantitating it and comparing it to intervention to the cath lab is difficult. It's usually plus or minus 15% compared to the cath lab. Really, we don't know. Is a stenosis causing ischemia? It's the debate we've had in cardiology for years. Anatomy or perfusion, which do we use to guide therapy? So the question is, are these, and this is supposed to be like a 50-60% stenosis, and that's supposed to be a heavily calcified vessel, are those causing this, which is a CT myocardial perfusion defect? So we've given adenosine, stress the heart, and we can see low density, low attenuation in the myocardium. That would be equivalent to a cold spot on a nuclear study or strep. So we're doing this stuff in Australia. We've been doing it for about a year and a half, where we're doing CT. There's a very high-grade stenosis. Doing cath, and we're doing FFR in the cath lab. And then we're doing these rest stress myocardial CT myocardial perfusion images. Here's the rest. I don't know how well you can appreciate from where you are, but on stress, it's all dark here in the anterior wall here, about from halfway down, mid and distal. You can see a little in these funny color maps. You can see up here rest and stress, that darkness. So we're starting to, and we're just getting a study published now with 80 patients, and the cool thing, several people have compared this to stress nuclear, but we've compared it to FFR, invasive FFR, fractional flow reserve, and we're finding very good correlation. So that's an exciting thing. Again, this kind of, here's the rest study, no dark spots in the myocardium. Here's the stress, you can see there, anterior wall ischemia. Now that's one way to do it. Here's the other cool thing. Here's what they're doing at Stanford, and I've had the privilege of working with these guys. There, I love this slide because we got these real smart fluid dynamics engineers. They're taking the CT data, and they use this this equation here, whatever that means, and put it in this black box, right? And I go, well, wait. But that's about what they'll tell me. And out the other end, it takes about 3 hours to process a study. But out the other end, they're able to calculate fractional flow reserve based on the CT data set. So I assume most of you know what fractional flow. We're looking at flow across stenoses to see if it's hemodynamically significant. So they've done this in a number of cases now. They've published several trials, just got another one accepted to JACC, and it correlates very well with invasive FFR. Now, this is the study I just showed you. I know I'm jumping around a little. Remember, I showed you that guy just about 3 minutes ago who had that LAD stenosis and a diagonal stenosis. Here he is. They ran him through that computational flow algorithm. Here's his FFR based just on the CT. This is a stenosis. Those of you know that do FFR know that less than 0.8 is kind of the magic number. That would mean it's flow limiting. And he does still have decent flow past his LAD. It's 0.85. Here in the diagonal, which I was pretty convinced was severe, it's less than 0.8. Interesting. Here's another view of his diagonal, a poor quality picture there, but this is the diagonal again. A second look at that. Here is the posterior descending. Remember that stenosis I showed you down here? And you can see that it's very close to 0.8, but not below it. So this is another exciting technology. If we can take in these equivocal cases with, you know, and either use the perfusion or use this FFR as it gets, it'll get faster. Right now it takes a couple hours, but it's getting faster and faster to decide. And now more and more people are getting pushed to use this kind of technology, FFR, to decide whether they're going to stent or not. You've kind of read about some of that, the FAME trial, et cetera. So I think, winding it up here, CT-based ED chest pain strategy, I think it's going to be a good gatekeeper for those low and intermediate pretest probability patients with better efficiency, lower costs, faster. And we may solve some of its Achilles heels, as I just showed you, with perfusion or the FFR CT. Nuclear is good. Nuclear is not going to go away. When we have someone come in, you know, kind of intermediate or high probability that has known bad coronary disease, CT probably isn't the way to go. They're going to have tons of calcium and hard to read. So nuclear definitely has a niche there, but maybe we'll be able to use the FFR, CT FFR as well. Cath, obviously, for high risk or high pretest probability. So maybe we'll have an algorithm that looks like this. The high risk will go for invasive cath. The lower intermediate will break into high intermediate or low pretest probability. The high pretest probability will go to cath. The very low, hopefully, will go home. If they have known coronary disease, they can be shunted to myocardial perfusion imaging. If they don't, we can find out with CT whether they have mild, moderate, or severe disease. The severes are going to, well, the milds we can send home and know there's going to be no events. The severes we're going to get to the cath lab where they need to be. And the moderates will either do perfusion imaging or hopefully on the same CT we could do the CT FFR or CT perfusion. So I think that will be the algorithm of the future in this kind of efficient care model. So I think, you know, when we talk about what best practices in imaging are, it's creating and utilizing pathways that lead to the most efficient care of the patient and really the best clinical care for the patient, the right technology used appropriately and efficiently to create best patient care and eliminate costs from the system, and perform to these value-based metrics which are rapidly being put in place. So I appreciate your attention. If you have any questions or want some of the reference lists for this, you can email me there. Thank you.